We're going to be showing you how we put up our yurts at Tractors and Cream. So we've got the blue yurt, which we've time-lapsed. So we've got a whole time-lapse of how it goes up. And then we've got the green yurt, which we've talked through each step. So I'm going to sort of intersect, so you'll see us talking about how we do it and then the time-lapse version of it. So hopefully it'll give you an all-round view of exactly how we build our yurts. So today is the most stressful day in the glamping calendar. It's putting up the yurts. We're going to try and get both up this week because Brian's got the week off work. My sister's come over to socially distantly help us because I find it really, really stressful. So that's what we're going to crack on and do. And hopefully in the next couple of days, we'll have both the yurts up.
This is the deer yurt, the green yurt. We're just busy putting in the kickstands. So what that actually allows you to do is to put the trellis up against the side and it won't actually slip off. But anyway, so what we've had to do is we've had to put the door over here to get that all level so that we can then start to figure out where to put the kickstand. So the kickstand is there, it stops the trellis from coming off. Vicky's just there putting it on. It's another scorcher of a day. Hopefully it'll all go well. So the kickstands are all now on the yurt. So what we're going to do now is we're going to pick up the trellises, which are just over here. So there's five trellises in total, and we're going to place them all around the yurt, getting them all locked into position. Then we're going to put the door up, feed the trellises into the side of the door, which will then lock it all into place, then get all the trellises to the right height, and then we should be good to go and start putting in the spokes. So if you look at a trellis, it's actually kind of concave and it bows in a bit, and that's what gives you the shape. So what Vicky's going to now do is she's actually going to open the trellis out, and then what we're going to do, you should see it should, so what it'll do is it'll fit there into the door. And what we need to do is we need to now get another trellis, because we will lash the other trellis to the side over here. The trellis is actually quite clever in that they all interlock into each other. So I just got to stand here and hold this so that it doesn't fall, whilst Vicky flexes her muscles and pulls in the other trellis. It's a good workout this, isn't it? And it's for free. Any other people out there wanting to come and help us, let us know. We're always looking
free
for
workout.
Yeah, free workout. We're always looking for a bit of help. To be fair, it's normally just Vicky and myself, and we get there in the end. So this is a bit where I say it all kind of interlocks.
You hold that. Oh, look, it just did it by itself.
See, you just need me to show you how it's done. So what's quite good is the structural integrity is now there. What we'll do is we'll just get a bit of rope and we'll lash it there just to stop it going whilst we're putting them up. So what happens then is the covers will go over and it kind of keeps everything in place. But that's far away down the line. We're still going to finish off these further three bits of trellis. Like I say, lash them and then hook them into the door and make sure that the trellises are all at exactly the same height as this is with the top of the door. If it's not, it will not work. The poles will fall out and we will get in the strop and we will not be happy. So fingers crossed we do it right this time. It took us 2 days to do the last one. I'm hoping to get this one done in a day.
No chance.
I know. I live in hope. The next job now is to hoist up the crown wheel and sit it on top of these two posts, which will then go up to create the roof structure where all of these posts or spokes will then fit into the crown wheel. So if you look around the crown wheel, there's little holes that go all the way around, and we've got to put a spoke in there and we've got to rest it on to the in between there. So, but first job, as I said, is hoisting that up. Vicky's got the rope there, which we will use to attach to the four points of the crown, and then attach it to the top of the door, and attach it to left and right, and the back of the trellis to then stabilize it sitting on top of these posts. So what we're doing here is we are attaching the post onto the crown wheel, and basically gravity will all hold it there eventually, but in the interim what we have to do is we've got to hold it in place, and then Vicky's just going to use some horsehair rope to lash it in place. The ropes have now been tied, so we've got a rope over there, a rope there. I think he's got a rope there which he's going to be pulling, and essentially what we're going to do is we're going to lay it down on its side. I'm going to lift up and Vicky's going to pull, and then it should pivot on the ends of the feet and stand upright. And if we totally cock it up, well, you guys can have a laugh at our expense.
Wait on me.
Can you go down there? You're pulling up. Well, as you can see, folks, if you leave Vicky to tie the knots, that's what happens. Well, sorry about that little interlude. We had a slight hiccup there. We think we're back on track and we're going to try again.
Do you want me to hold on to you?
No, I think I've done it. Okay, so what you need to do, okay, you ready to pull?
Yeah, I'll bring it back a bit first.
Okay, hey, pull, go first, stand further back, stand further back. There we go, and it's upright. It's now standing upright. You can let go, Vicky, it's not going anywhere. And it's just kind of supported there with these three ropes. Realistically, we should have had a fourth rope coming down over here, but Vicky's kind of lost the rope, so we're having to use this oversized rope, and turns out we don't have enough. Which is a bit of a pain, but it makes our life a bit more exciting. So now what we're going to do, we're going to start sticking the spokes into all of these holes and then resting them on there, and hope and pray that we've got this totally equidistant. Actually, that's a good point. We should actually measure between the leg and the trellis just to make sure that that's bang on.
Okay.
Cool. So I've got all the spokes laid out all the way around the yurt, and the reason for that is when you're starting to feed the spokes in, you don't want to have to be going back and forth, looking for spokes. And so we're hoping that this will go pretty swimmingly, because this is always the bit for us that tends to go wrong. So Vicky's going to demonstrate for us how to put in a spoke. So she lines it up, finds the hole, and sticks it in the hole. And then she's just going to try and hook the horsehair on to hold the spoke there. This part of the horsehair holding in the spoke is solely just to keep it there till such time as the covers can come on, because once the covers come on, they put pressure on there and they will hold those spokes in for you.
I just hate this part.
I know you hate this, but it's a necessary evil.
Okay.
Like I said, let's not do yurts ever.
Okay.
I know they're pretty and everything, but check that out. That's the dome. Everybody said, oh, dome, really difficult to put up. Whoever did that never put up a yurt. That there, piece of cake to put up. Really simple. Bolts together very nicely, really precisioned engineered. This, bit more haphazard, but then it's a bit more rustic, and I suppose that's what the appeal is. Oh, here we've got Vicky coming in again with another one. How's it looking?
Commentating a horse race.
Is it going to go in? And where, oh, yeah, it's contact.
Okay, that's sort of all right.
Okay, so yeah, so it's all looking good at the moment.
No, it's not.
Why is it not? Ye of little faith. I thought you were always the optimistic one.
Normally, not in yurts, no.
Okay, so you're going to put in another one over here?
I've got quite a lot on this side.
Okay. So somewhere something hasn't gone right.
Is it because it's slightly higher than that?
Look at all of this that Vicky's got overhanging there versus down over here where we've practically got nothing overhanging. And this is the problem with yurts. Even though everything has been measured correctly, we still somehow managed to not get it right. And this is what I really and truly hate about yurts. You can do everything and think it's all done perfectly, but the thing still doesn't work properly. So, I think domes all round and a can of petrol for this one. Ah, and there's Vicky, she's not looking happy.
Okay.
Deep breaths, giving birth. Yes, I know this is like giving birth. Real difficult, okay. Got to push through, but we will push through and come out on the other side stronger. So we're at the point here where we started putting in a whole load of spokes. So we've got some done at the front, some done either side, and then a whole load done here at the back, with the idea being that you want to distribute them evenly as you go around to make sure that it all, you've got the right amount of overhang as you go along. quite pleased with this. This one was not as painful as the blue one. The blue one, it took us about, I think it was a day and a half to get to this point, whereas this has taken us about maybe 2.5-3 hours. So yeah, good news all round. Yeah. We've still got all the covers to put on the yurts. We made a real good progress yesterday getting all the woodwork up, and now it's just putting all the canvases and insulation on as soon as I can get the workforce out of the hammocks and back to work. So this is the first step, it's just getting this on, very light material. Got to find the door, and then you line it all up from the door, then you work your way around. The line has all been added now, so as you can see, it's suddenly starting to make it feel a little bit more homely. Next part that we're doing is we're hanging up the insulation. The way how it works is we've got a drawstring there, you hang the panel up onto the yurt and then pull the drawstring tight, and then it will secure it in place. There's two panels that we now need to get up of insulation and hang them on the wall. The wall insulation has all now been put onto the yurt, and as I said before, it's all held together with this rope here, which then kind of contracts in and then holds it just sitting over the top. It then joins here at the back, because as I said before, it's in two sections. This is the knots that's with tension to keep it all in place. The next part now is to get the roof insulation and put that on. Once again, that's in two sections, and then that will hang over and cover up a lot of this rope, and that, so you won't see any of that.
So next we're going to do the roof, which is blinking heavy, and so we need to get it up and then tie it around the top of the crown, and then that should sit on top and keep all the walls nice and secure. So right, give me a hand then.
Well, you've pushed the roof calm insulation up, Vicky's up there now just pulling it all around. That was a bit of a struggle because one of our ropes that we were using has popped out, which then meant we had to go back to the drawing board and come up with another plan. But we seem to have got there. Vicky's looking a little worse for wear up there. She's trying to use all of her muscles to move the roof around. I suppose I better go and give her a hand. On a scale to 1 to 10, how much fun are you having?
1.5.
Why so little? The yurt's almost up.
I'll be happy when it's up, yeah.
Okay, so what are you doing at the moment?
I'm just tying this roof panel to itself so that it stays where it is, but I'm notoriously bad at doing tight knots. Okay. I'm the only one that can fit up here because Brian can't get his shoulders through the gap. So you need a small person, not that I'm very small, but a smaller person to get through the gap.
We have completed putting all the insulation roof panels on. Now what we have to do is we have to put on a further really thick heavy duty canvas, which is all in one piece, which we have to hang up. Once again, it's got the same drawstring methodology that you just pull it at the top. Although Vicky, as I said, we need blue rope because that white stuff's gonna fray. And it's just in one long piece and it goes all the way around. So we set it up all the way around the yurt, so that we literally just have to lift it all up and feed it all the way around, and then pull the drawstring, and theory is it should just stay there. We've hung the big heavy duty tarpaulin out of cover now on, and it's, as I said before, it's all fixed with just this little rope at the top here, pulled tight, and then it holds it all in place, makes it really nice and warm, also adds a bit of waterproofing. But now what we have to do is we have to put the actual waterproofing cover over the whole top of this. So the way that we pull this particular sheet or tarpaulin up and onto the roof is we feed a blue rope through and then we tie it back on itself. And Vicky then goes up the ladder out through the crown hole and she pulls and I push. And then basically we pull it into place. It's not too heavy. The green one there is by far the heaviest one, I would have said. It weighs an absolute ton, and hanging that up, your arms ache by the end, but it's all good. So yeah, Vicky's tied a knot there. She loves tying knots. She's gonna pull it into place, and then I'll have to throw the rope up to her, and I'll have to push, and she'll have to pull. Hey, hey! So we've got the main waterproof lining on now. That wasn't too difficult, luckily. So now comes the main shell, which goes over the whole top of this and basically just pulls the whole thing in. And then we put three belly bands around, which are big straps that go all the way around and tightens it all up and makes it really tight so that it's not going to go anywhere. Last one to put on now, and it is the main canvas shell that goes over the whole top. Once again, we're using our trusty blue rope to feed it through. This time what we're doing is we're looking for where the door is, but then looking for the back of that, and then we're going to feed our blue rope through the crown hole and the back of it. And then once again we'll throw the rope over the yurt. One of us will do pulling and the other one will do the pushing to get it to come up and over. We're halfway through putting the main shell cover on, and Vicky's up the top there trying to sort it all out. Oh, you're in the sun, you're working out. Oh, it's great. What more could you want? Imagine doing this in the pouring rain,
which we have done.
Yeah, that wasn't fun. Here we have it, a yurt that's 99% complete. Well, all anything that we have left to do now is to attach three belly bands to these hooks, take the belly bands all around, and then attach them to the hooks on this side. There you can see this here, that's our door thing. And then that'll pull it all in and pull it nice and tight and keep it pretty secure. I think what we do need to find out is, do we keep yurts or do we get rid of yurts and have something else? And if we do get rid of some, what would we change them to?
So I would be tempted to have three domes because you can leave them up all year round. This taking down and putting up of yurts business is an absolute nightmare. This is why I kind of thought, could we get a winter cover for the yurts, and then maybe that would, we could keep them up all year round, but we've still got the issue of the wind, like the wind gets really bad here in the winter. So the domes are much more wind resistant. Or maybe there's something else, maybe we need to reapply for planning permission to get wooden structures rather than canvas. But if you would like to leave us any messages in the comments and say what you think we should do, we'd be greatly appreciated of your help. We really hope you enjoyed this episode of Behind the Scenes here at Tractors and Cream. If you could leave us a comment, let us know what you liked, let us know if it was helpful, and if you could subscribe to our channel, that would be even better.